I hope now they can hear me, and you will hear the translated version as well. Good. So let's begin. Why are we interested in determining the importance of household debt? Well, on the one hand, if you look at the CC region that we have already looked in the past presentation, and then you see a rapid increase in household lending up to 40% of the GDP before 2008. Since then, it's lower and more or less stable, quite somewhat lower than the euro area. And household lending is a determinant for first financial stability. There are estimations that suggest that values above 30% of household debt relative to the GDP could pose threats to financial stabilities. On the other hand, there's also the financial inclusion concerns. So these are possible reasons why we should be interested in household debt. Before we get to our research question, if household debt is related to income inequality, let's take a step further and say, okay, how is the distribution of income a determinant of household distribution? According to standard theories, such as the life cycle hypothesis, it should not be a determinant, but empirical work, especially for the US, before the financial crisis, have shown that poor US households increase their consumption as a reaction to higher top income shares or consumption levels. So the reason why the distribution of income can affect household consumption, on one hand, the demand side is the keeping up with the Joneses effect. So this is what obviously what our paper title refers to, because we look at CC countries. We don't keep up with the Joneses, we keep up with the Novaks. It's a common name in these countries, a non-extensive Wikipedia research showed. I don't know if it's the most prevalent name, but a very prevalent name. This keeping up with the Joneses effect has been researched first by Veblen and then by Duesenberry more than 100 years ago. And it states that their own consumption and their own utility of consumption depends on the consumption of others and also on the income of others as a proxy for consumption. And if you interact more with more affluent groups, then you drive up spending. And a similar concept, very much related to this concept, is conspicuous consumption or positional consumption, or also the notion of expenditure cascades. So when we wrote the paper, I looked up, where does keeping up with the Joneses come from even? You know, it's also a very, very much, a common phrase. So if you see here in the books, you know, collected by Google, it starts to appear in the beginning of the 20th century. So was there an important paper or an important book? Not really, it was a comic. It was a comic called Keeping Up with the Joneses, and here you see a married couple, and the wife suggests some very elegant and special attire to her husband, like a green hat or yellow gloves or something like this. He doesn't like this, and the reason for this is that she saw their neighbors, the Joneses, having these kind of things. So they want to keep up with the Joneses. So this is where this expression comes from. So, and now to our question, does this keeping up with the Joneses, that is income inequality, having an impact on consumption, does this also translate to consumer credit? The rationale being that if inequality increases, and high-income households consume relatively more than low-income households, low-income households try to maintain high level of consumption and they fund this debt. Especially when in the 70s and 80s consumer credit, for example in the US, became a thing. This is why this effect was found, for example, for the US for 1980 to 2000. So this is the keeping up with the Joneses effect, inequality and consumer credit. There are various papers researching this. There's one very interesting paper that states quite the opposite to some extent. of Olivier Corbillon and others, 2013. They look at the supply side channel. Because using micro data from the US, they found the opposite effect that they're keeping up with the Joneses effect. They found that low-income households in high inequality regions actually accumulate less debt when you compare them with similar households in low inequality regions. They also found that in those high inequality regions, the price of credit is actually higher, especially the price for low income households, and those low income households get denied mortgage credits more than comparable households in low inequality regions. And the way they rationalize these empirical findings is that they argue that there is a supply-side channel. They say, as income inequality rises, it becomes easier for banks to target richer households. And because income is a very good proxy for creditworthiness, if income inequality, if the gap between the rich and poor widens, banks actually start to target more the richer households, and they're more able to determine the creditworthy and the not creditworthy households. So this is the model they set up there, and they provide some empirical evidence that supports these notions. So we have seen now a demand side, keeping up with the NOVACs, and a supply side, this supply side channel. In reality, what we see when we look at households having a loan, this is an equilibrium outcome that we see. So this is somewhat hard to disentangle demand and supply forces. And we will, in our paper, look a bit into this. So we look at this question, how the income distribution is relevant for household debt for 10 CZ countries from 2019 to 2018. So we have a bit more data. You already heard a bit about this data. We have around 1,000 households per country and per year. Again, we have the income question. We already heard about this. We know about the net income. We had to do some corrections to estimate some of the missing parts. And now for the inequality measure. In the papers so far, what is most used is the Gini coefficient. But also papers that look more at this conspicuous consumption type of channels, they argue that it is actually not the income of the whole distribution that plays a role, but that households of people are upward looking. So they look at richer households when they change their consumption. So they don't look at the poorer households, what they consume, what their income is, but the richer households. So we adapt in line with Drexler, Grau and Schmidt 2014, a relative income measure, which just states, okay, we take the households that are higher income deciles than me, take the average of their income, and then put it relative to my own income. So we have this measure for every household. So it's not a measure of inequality in regions or countries, but we have this measure for every household. How much on average do richer households earn? Okay. And yeah, in contrast to Drexler, Grau and Schmidt, we put this in relative, so we compare it to their own income, which is also a way to include their own income. When you look at this relative reference income measure, you see here in the graph, on the x-axis you see regional income deciles, on the y-axis you see this relative reference income measure. And you see, of course, for the first income decile, sometimes this measure is fairly high, indicating that those in higher deciles than in the first deciles have, you know, incomes up to 60 or sometimes also 80 times more than myself. As for the household debt, we only observe the extensive margin, so we only know if the household currently has a debt or not. But we don't observe the amount. So we don't really observe the amount in currency, how large the debt is, but only if the household has a debt or not. And we regress the probability of the household having a debt or not on this relative reference income and some some other variables. I will skip that. We also talked a bit about the multi-level models, which we apply here as well. In short, you can say that you allow for random coefficients and random slopes, random constants, if the households are nested in certain regions. So I will. We can skip that. That was just to show you that when you look at the social demographics, you include that is if the household head is male or female, the age squared, children, education, employment status. We don't have very surprising results. For the sake of that you can read actually what's here, I will skip now this information in the table we have. So I'll skip these covariates, these are social demographic covariates. I will skip also that we have included country dummies and year dummies. So let's go straight to the first set of results. In the second column, no interaction, you see the probability of having alone interacted on just the reference income measures. And what you see here is a negative coefficient. That means a higher reference measure, higher inequality, is here associated with the lower probability of having a loan. So this speaks more for the supply side channel. But here we just, you know, put it in raw as it is. And in the third column, highlighted here, this is kind of the main result of the paper. Here we interact the relative income reference measure, we interact it with the regional income deserts. And what we see here is what we will see in many specifications, that for the bottom of the distribution, the first and the second decile, there is this negative association. So higher relative reference income, higher income inequality is associated with lower probability of having a loan. What does it mean? I presented you two possible channels. This means that this demand channel, this keeping up with the Novak channel, is weaker or maybe even is not there in the lower part of the distribution, but the signaling channel, the supply side channel, is there. So when income inequality increases, apparently credit is diverted away from the bottom of the distribution. When you look at the top of the distribution from the sixth decile onward, it is the opposite that emerges. So you see that higher reference income, higher income inequality is in fact associated with higher probability of the household having a loan. So this is both consistent with the supply side story, but this is also consistent with the keeping up with the Novak story. So possibly both of these channels are at work. And yeah, I mean, this is a probability estimation because our dependent variable indicates if the household has a loan or not, 0, 1. So these coefficients should not be interpreted quantitatively, but only qualitatively. To look at the quantitative effect, you can have a look at the marginal effects. For example, at the top left, you see the marginal effects for the baseline estimation. And for the eighth percentile, for example, an increase in 1 in this relative reference income measure would lead to 2% increase of the probability of having a loan. So it's sizable, it's not huge, I would say. And you see this pattern for a couple of specifications. Said that. I will skip that for sake of time. So until now, you maybe have noted that I am somewhat not referring very much to causality, but to association, because, you know, we don't have really something like an instrumental variable strategy or something. But one step in this direction is this omitted variable bias or endogeneity concerns. For example, if you think about general favorable economic conditions in a country, I mean, this should be controlled for by our year dummies and by our country doubles, but it's good to think about these problems that can arise. So if there are favorable local economic conditions, this could drive both the relative reference income measures, because maybe richer households profit more of growth, and also increase the supply of of household loans. So this would drive both the variables, and we would this would mean we have a spurious regression going on. We have information about the currency in which the loans are denominated in. And if these kind of problems appear, we would expect it to be more sizable, or to be more sizable for local currencies, because if foreign currency loans, if the effect on foreign currency loans are nil, we should be concerned, because foreign currency loans are often in our dataset given out by banks that have not their headquarters in these countries, but in foreign countries. So this interaction, at least at country level or region level, should primarily affect local currency loans. And what we see here is, I just show the marginal effects. On the bottom right, you see this currency, you see these loans denominated only in local currency. The effect is fairly strong. But on the top left, you see loans only denominated in foreign currency. And while the effect is somewhat smaller, you still see, for the top of the distribution, a positive effect. For combinations of these loans, the effect is somewhat not there, but also here the sample sizes are much, much smaller. The largest part of debt in our sample is only foreign currency or only local currency. Here we played around a bit with definitions of this alternative reference income definitions. In the second column, you could argue that maybe my upward-looking comparison does only compromise the next decile, so people that are somewhat close to me economically, but not those at the top, far away. We still see a very similar pattern. Same for the same education, same age group, and all richer households, not only in other deciles. So we see this pattern is very robust to alternative definitions of this reference income. We also performed these estimations on other inequality ratios, because in literature the Gini is often used, or some percentile ratios. For the Gini coefficient, we see that the top of the distribution, we still have this positive effect. More inequality leads to more debt, or on the extended margin. At the bottom, there is no significant effect to be found. For some other inequality measures, thank you, like the 19th and 10th percentile ratio, 75-25 percentile ratio, the top shares of the 1, 5, or 10% of income, respectively. It's a bit different for each inequality measure, but we see the story as a whole holds for most of these measures. So at the bottom, with a negative effect or negative correlation, and at the top, there is this positive estimates. And for the bottom 10%, bottom 20%, there is nothing to be found, but we also would not expect it. And the last measure is just the Coebion 2013 measure, just a direct comparison with this paper, because we reference this paper a lot. I'll skip that. So, and the last thing I want to comment is that in this data, we don't only have the question, do you have a loan, but we also have a question on, do you plan a loan in the next 12 months? So this provides us with an opportunity to disentangle a bit demand and supply factors that determine loans. Because when we ask for loan, or when the survey asks for loan plans, we are a bit closer to the demand side. I mean, of course, there could be households that don't plan a loan because they know, okay, they have no income, they have no collateral, they don't even bother going to the bank because they know they have no chance getting a loan. But for others, they maybe plan to get a loan, and then when they go to the bank, they get rejected or not. So we're closer to the demand side than if they have a loan question. And what we see here is, on overall, the effect is much smaller, and we don't have so much of these nice significant stars. But we see that at the top of the distribution, there for some specifications, you know, the second column is the baseline specification. Do I have to, no? You see for the seventh decile, seventh, eighth is a dubious significant level, but for the ninth decile, there is this positive effect. When you look at the fourth column, we look at loan plans that were planned to finance a car. Here we see the strongest effect from all the compared to other loan plans. And in the seventh and eighth column, we split the sample to regions with low inequality and high inequality. And what we see here is that the effect is mainly existent or driven by regions with high inequality. So this is something that in literature is found sometimes, that these effects generally, both the keeping up with the NOVACs and the signaling effect, they're both stronger in regions where there is a high inequality to begin with. So in high inequality regions, this effect is somewhat strong. So I just sum up. We investigated the nexus between income inequality and household debt in CZ countries. A result we see very often in our estimations is that there is a positive relation at the top of the income distribution, consistent both with keeping up with the NOVACs and the signaling channel, the supply side channel. And at the bottom of the distribution, the supply side, the signaling channel seems to prevail, it seems to be stronger. This finding is robust to other income inequality measures, at least to some extent when we look at the Gini. And also loan plans are affected by reference income changes at the top of the distribution. And what we see also is that it is very worthwhile to look at the details of the distribution. So just not look at the debt variable, but to split it up according to income deciles. We see that there's considerable heterogeneity, I think demanding more research also. Thank you.
Again, I'm not an expert on equality. I remember from my past Duesenberry and Roosevelt, but the first question I have, and you discussed this with some of the omitted variable bias problem. You know, why would the Novak effect, or the Sweden effect, be such an important driver and long time to think of a lot of other behavioral patterns that they need have along, where it does not depend on the interaction with other people, but on my economic situation, how rational I am, what kind of capitalism I'm able to do. So you don't discuss this in some sense in the paper, because I don't think that the business cycle and these demographics are enough to basically prevent having barriers in your progression. So I think this would be the important one. Now, the other interesting points is one is measurement error, measurement problems. I mean, if I understand this and calculate these relative income thresholds or levels using self-assessed income by households. So, one question, which I don't think I've seen in the paper, is whether and this is of course biased about this outfit, whether across the distribution, how much you admit or protest to earn depends on where you're located. I'm not sure how this affects your attention. Now, the third point that you also indicated is how you cannot get into tangled dependent supply effects. Now, you use the willingness to take a loan, but this might be pie in the sky, this might be free. Now, if you have, let's say, camel data or something, something like to test your range of causality to see whether the willingness to take your leads to take up thoughts. But you don't. So you would see, somehow try to see whether the long willingness to thoughts leads to take up thoughts. I think that maybe. Now, the other thing when it comes to regions, that you basically say the development effect is stronger in the region. But I mean, that is European constitutions, which are quite large. So, so I understand that you might have a neighborhood effect. Either, if I'm in a certain class, I relate to just the class above me, so to speak. This is country-wise. This has nothing to do with the people who live next door to me. But if it is the people who live next door to me, then if you have large regions, the fact that the guy who lives at the other end of the region, I'm not going to be the one to imitate. So, from a conceptual point of view, to say that it has to be at the regional level, maybe at the country level is as relevant, or if it's at the regional, if it's at the local level, then you don't have enough data from it and so on. But I think the argumentation, I'm not the metric, but the argumentation is weak.
Thank you.
So they might want to keep up, but they decided, okay, now with such inequality, I'm just not able. So maybe on lower effects of inequality, moderate rise of inequality would still result in some positive take up of credit, but further rise of inequality just makes this impossible for them, and they just keep this strategy. So maybe you can try some nonlinear interactions.
Yeah, that's a very good point, and that's one possibility is also to interpret this as, there are studies for the US that show that even at the bottom of the distribution there's this positive effect of inequality on debt. So this is some kind of, and in our data set it's exactly the opposite. But you're right, I think it depends also on financial inclusion, and that these are often regions and countries with relatively high inequality, this could be both. You're right, this could be both via supply effect, so that the banks target richer households, and demand factors to say, okay, we interpret this, the households interpret this high inequality as, you know, some kind of bad sign for the economy, and they abstain. That's right. We cannot really pinpoint the exact effect. That's right. That's a good point to try to have a nonlinear, to try to pin down nonlinear effect. Yeah. Thank you.
Thank you very much.
And the question was why.
The information about whether the household have taken the loan, right? So this would be much more richer, much more informative exercise.
The question was why we don't use the HFCS, the Household Finance and Consumption Survey. That's right, that's a very good data set, but it's on entirely a different region. So to have the CC countries, this household data set is actually more complete and also with much longer. So we have this data from 2009 to 2018, HFCS, we have only three waves. And, you know, for this region, the completeness for this region is better with the Euro survey. But you're completely right. You could do this exercise also with the HFCS data.
What we could do, but we haven't done, is double check the countries where this survey is available before we check finding. Because it's not for the
bank,
and this is not
available
for the survey. It's only available for a couple of countries.
Yes, but you have the value of loans,
that,
right?
That's true.
Much more meaningful.
I think even the Stefan Jestl, I think, works on this. I don't know if it's published yet, but there is a colleague is working on a very similar. Yeah.
Okay, thank you very much. We are going to the second presentation. So please, today is